So on the 28th of September, that was the day of Yom Kippur, the morning of Yom Kippur. So as usual, at 9 in the morning, I knelt down to pray. And as I knelt down, my spiritual eyes were opened. And I looked into heaven, I saw a group of angels and saints of God. They were going somewhere. So I was wondering, where is everyone going to? And they all like seemed in a hurry to go. And as I was looking, one among the many angels turned and looked at me and he said, "Come and join us." So I asked them, "Where are you all going?" He said, "Come quickly," which means don't ask questions, just come, just come. So the next moment I was translated and I joined the angels and they said, "Come, let's go quickly." And we came to the throne room, not the throne room, but another place where all the people in heaven gather before the Lord Jesus Christ. So it was like a large square, like a meeting area, and there was a huge group, mostly saints in heaven, angels of God, and there were some people from the earth who were invited there. So when I reached there, so let's suppose, to just give you an idea, let's suppose the size of the gathering hall is about the size of this church. So I came and stood right at the back. You know, they all are saints and I'm just a commoner, isn't it? Right, yeah, I'm a commoner, you know. So I always feel a little bit shy. And a little bit, I don't even say little bit, too much, unqualified to stand in that holy gathering. So I stood right at the back. And one great saint from the Bible days, he turned and he looked. He said, "Where is..." He called me by my first name. He said, Where is he?" So someone pointed out, "There, he's right at the back." He said, "Bring him to the front." So I was brought to the front and I saw Neville Johnson standing there. So he stood there. I have seen him many times, you know, in the spiritual realm, in the heavenly places. And he stood there in the front, and as soon as he saw me, "Sadhu," you know, like he normally does. That has not changed. That's that style and his mannerism of calling me, "So sadhu, come, 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 come and stand here." So I stood between Neville Johnson and the other biblical saint. And so I asked the biblical saint, who was like a special watcher over my life, "Why are we here?" So he told me, "Today the Lord is going to make a very important announcement. That is why we all are gathered here. And that is the reason why you have been brought here. Because your job is going to bring this message to the world. So that's why you are here." So then the Lord began to speak. First, he spoke generally. And then he looked specifically at me and he said, "Now, this is what you must bring to the nations." And saying that, he said, "Before you give the word, you must show them one thing and place it on the pulpit, and then you give this word." So that's what I'm going to do now. I've never done anything like this in my entire life. So this will be a first. All of you know what is this, right? Is this good sign or bad sign? Okay, now I deliver to you the word of the Lord, verbatim. I'm not going to add one word more. I'm not going to one word subtract. I'm going to read to you as how the Lord spoke to me. The nations are weighed in the balances and found wanting. That's the first word. You read this in Daniel chapter 5, verses 25 to 28. And this is the inscription that was written. So what happens here is, if you may remember this passage in the book of Daniel, King Belshazzar had threw a great party for his nobles, his wives and everybody. And as they were drinking from the holy vessels from the Jerusalem temple, the hand of the Lord appeared and began to write on the wall. You remember that incident? Okay, that is what is, that's the passage I'm reading from. So the hand wrote four words. Okay, so now we'll continue from the scriptures. Daniel chapter 5, verses 25 to 28. And this is the inscription that was written, Mene, Mene, Tekel, Upasin. And this is the interpretation of each word. Mene, God has numbered your kingdom and finished it. Tekel, you have been weighed in the balance and found wanting. And Peres, your kingdom has been divided and given to the Medes and the Persians. So this is a passage of scripture that we find in the book of Daniel. And the word of the Lord that he first spoke is, the nations are weighed in the balance and they are found wanting, meaning lacking. They are lacking. On one side is the righteous standard of God. On the other side is the standards that are practiced in the nation. The heart and the soul of the nation, how does it stand? So they are put on one side and God's holy standard on one side, and then to see which goes higher, which goes lesser, or they stay balanced, equal. So the standards of the nations are equal to the standards of God. And the Lord Jesus continued to say, my Father's hour of judgment is coming. Who will bear? It will be fire and brimstone. Now the word fire and brimstone was first mentioned in Genesis chapter 19 verse 24, where we read that God rained down fire and brimstone upon Sodom and Gomorrah. So when the Lord spoke this, all the saints that were gathered there, they lifted up their voice at the same time and they said, oh Lord, your judgments are right. The nations are turned against you and your laws. They have devised wicked ways against your kingdom and your children. Their thoughts are wicked. So after saying this, then the Lord spoke this. Now this is about the United States of America. So from now onwards, whatever I'm going to share with you is all centered on the United States of America. America will be judged. That's why this weighing scale is here. And I'm sure you have heard this over and over and over, and so much so, most Christians just couldn't care less about the word America will be judged. Am I right?
Yes.
Am I right?
Yes.
Let's be honest.
Yes.
Am I right?
Yes.
You see, you have heard this over and over. Even I myself have stood here and in several other conferences in the US, and I've said the same thing. But if God had judged when he first spoke those words, where would we be today? We would have been gone to hell, you know. Right? You wouldn't be sitting here and enjoying the grace of God. If he had executed his judgment there and then, when the word was first spoken over this nation, where would we be? So again, he extends his grace. He extends his grace. One more year, Lord. One more year. One more year. The Lord Jesus Christ goes and stands before the Father God and he prays, one more year. One more year. One more year. It's because of his prayers, the judgment is postponed, postponed, and postponed. But there will come a time where it cannot be postponed anymore. Right? There will always come a time. And now is that crucial time. That is why at such a time as this, the Lord specifically told me, now you go and bring this message. So America will be judged. How will she be judged? Two ways. A flood is determined for her. It will devastate the Mideast. A fire is appointed for her. It will devastate the Midwest. So to the east is a flood, to the west is fire. I don't exactly know why, but I'm just saying to you what the Lord told me. A flood is determined for her. It will devastate the Mideast. And a fire is appointed for her. It will devastate the Midwest. Then the Lord Jesus looked at me and he said, now I want you to go to America and warn them of the judgment that is coming upon them. Now please listen very carefully. If they choose the wrong president. You know, this is the second time in my entire ministry in the US from 1991 till now, where the Lord specifically spoke to me concerning the destiny of the United States in relationship to choosing the right president. I've never heard from the Lord in the previous years like that. So, he said, go and warn them of the judgment that will come upon them if they choose the wrong president. He, now referring to Mr. Trump, should continue for another term for God's purposes to be done for this nation. Which means God is extending his grace towards the United States of America for one more time. One more time. You know, sometimes you cannot see what is taking place behind the scene. We look at a person's external acts and then we want to hurl stones at him, throw all kinds of brickbats. This is a good for nothing president. This is not nonsense president. During a recent online study that we were doing, I felt a stirring one day, and I made an appeal to all the students who were on our class. I said, I call for a 21-day Daniel fast for the US elections, which should have begun from the 12th of October, and 21 days will last right up to a day before the US election, November 2. It will last that long. So I said, I feel a great stirring in my spirit. This nation is at a crossroad, and you should not vote for the wrong guy. So wrong guy should not come to office. If a wrong guy comes to office, then this nation is doomed. You are doomed for good. No more salvation. So I felt a great stirring in my spirit. I'm not here to tell you how to vote. I'm here to tell you what God thinks. Amen. That's my job. Amen. To reveal to you the mind of the Lord. Yes. To reveal to you the will of the Lord. That's my job. Then you decide. So, he, Mr. Trump, should continue for another term for God's purposes to be done for this nation. Which means they are not finished yet. God wants to give you another 4 years of grace. 4 years to restart something. Restart. It's a restart. So this first 4 years was just following the ground. Following the ground. So the next 4 years will be for the seeds to germinate, for the shoots to come, and for flowers to come, and for fruits to come, and the tree to blossom and grow. And you will be once more be a respected nation, a nation that's looked up. Presently, I'm sad to say this. I'm sorry to say this. No nation in the world respects America. The high reputation that America once had is at all-time low. It's not because of Mr. Trump, not because of him. It's a system that has accumulated like dust, you know. Dust gathers dust, accumulated to what, where we are today. But the purposes of God for this nation is not over yet. And on the, so the first part of the word I received on Yom Kippur. Then on the 5th of October, as I was studying the book of Daniel in chapter 11, suddenly I saw a vision. And the Lord began to speak to me about the United States again. And he said, three powerful prince angels are stationed with President Trump. Just like the angels stood with King Darius to strengthen him. You read that in Daniel chapter 11 verse 1. This angel who stood with King Darius. Now King Darius is not a Christian. He's not even a Jew. He's a Gentile. A Persian king. But God's prince angel was appointed to stand with him, to guard him and protect him. In the similar manner, three powerful prince angels are stationed with President Trump. And they will strengthen him and he will triumph. So what exactly that word triumph means, I don't know. It can mean he will be re-elected. It can also mean he will overcome all the brickbats that were thrown at him. He will triumph. So I don't want to add in my own opinion or commentary there. And the Lord Jesus said this, I love him. He is my servant. And when the Lord Jesus spoke that, I saw tears coming down his eyes. He said, I love him. He is my servant. He will fulfill my will for this nation as well as for Israel. If the Christians in this country will gather together in groups, in churches, to pray sincerely, without prejudice and bias, then I will push back the enemy's plans to thwart Trump. Right now, all hell has been released against Mr. Trump. That is why even the good media who are supporting him suddenly turned violent. Suddenly have turned against him. It is all the work of the enemy. How can they suddenly change? Nobody suddenly changes, you know. It's the work of the enemy. So what does this tell us? Prayers for the president has gone way down. Way down. See, when you see all this happening, have you raised up an army to stand in the gap? Do a 24/7 prayer watch. Let's surround the president with prayer. Make sure he is fully guarded. How many we sincerely do that? To just simply pray a normal prayer amounts to nothing. To really intercede is different. Anybody can simply pray. Simple prayer is not enough for this kind of warfare that we are entering into, like what the destiny of the nation is. You need to enter into serious intercession, seriously locking horns with the enemy. Then the warfare will stop. Then the enemy's plans to thwart the election or to rig the election will all be failed. Even, you know, do you know that even a large number of evangelical Christians don't want to vote for Mr. Trump anymore? I am shocked. So they'll rather have a wrong man into the office than God's choice. If you look at the history of the kings in the Bible, even those who are handpicked by God, they were never perfect. Right? They were never perfect. But they were God's choice. So you cannot expect a perfect person to be in the office when the citizens are not perfect. Right? When we are not perfect, how can you expect another man to be perfect? There'll be bound to be ups and downs. The most important issue is, who is God's man? God calls Nebuchadnezzar, another heathen king, he's my servant. Cyrus, another heathen king, he was called by name in the Bible, you know, 500 years before he was born. I was amazed when I read the scriptures, you know, maybe 100 years before Cyrus was ever born, his name is written in the Bible, and God calls him, he is my servant who will do my will. And during the reign of King Cyrus, what is that one will of God that he did? To release the Jews to go back to Jerusalem. And then finance them to rebuild the walls of Jerusalem and to build the temple again. That's all he did. And that was his destiny. But how was his reign during his entire lifetime? Nebuchadnezzar, extremely prideful, arrogant king. But God calls him my servant, who will execute my will. So don't look at the externalities of a person and then throw brickbats and judge them. What's most important is, what is God's choice? Who is God's choice? Then cast your vote to God's choice. I will show him my favor and shower my grace upon him. He is a broken man within him and fights for survival. This is how God sees him. You know, I bet none of us knows what Mr. Trump feels in his bedroom. right? When he's all alone in his bedroom, how you will never know his heart. But God is seeing his heart. And he's saying, he's fighting for survival. Not even the next term, you know. Even to finish his term, he's fighting for his survival. He's a broken man. The very people who should support him, even if they turn against him, the evangelical Christians, if they turn against him, then you will lose all hope, isn't it? So I will show him my favor and shower my grace upon him, for he is a broken man within him and fights for survival. All the nasty attacks against him show the sinful and evil nature of the majority of the people of this nation, who want unrighteousness to triumph. There is an evil plan by the LGBT community to vote Trump out and transform this nation into Sodom and Gomorrah. Their borders are not secure. The southern entry is where evil is brought into this nation. Even witchcraft, sorcery, and abominations of many kinds are brought into this country through that access. The enemy is fighting hard to prevent the wall of protection from coming up. You know, I have seen in multiple visions that groups and groups of witches and wizards chanting and putting curses upon Mr. Trump. They are chanting, they are concocting all these potions, and they are putting curses upon him. And also, they are working doubly hard so that Judge Amy is not voted to become a Supreme Court justice. It's all the plans of their enemy, working terribly hard. And what do the Christians do? Sleep. You don't care. When they who work for Satan can be so fervent, how should the church be? No, you are fighting with one another. Right? We are busy making videos and putting on YouTube, criticizing this church, this pastor against that pastor, against this, against that. What are we doing? Instead of using the sword to fight against the devil, we are using the sword to fight with one another. Is that the reason why the Holy Spirit gave you that sword? The sword of the Spirit is not to fight with each other. I am not your enemy. You are not my enemy. Right? The principalities, the powers, and the rulers of darkness, and the spiritual wickedness in the high places, they are our enemy. So we should war against them, not against one another. But look how successfully the enemy has caused us to be diverted. But even in the midst of all this, that is why God finds us absolutely untrustworthy. So one last chance now. You're still about what, 3 weeks from your election? So about 3 weeks from election. So I humbly and lovingly ask you on behalf of the kingdom of God, the Lord God who sent me to you, to stand in the gap, to fast and pray for your president. And every Christian in America will make the right choice. They will not be swayed by popular opinion. They will not sway by all the propaganda that's come from the media. All those things that are against, they will not be fooled. But the angels of God will go forth and to lead and guide every American, especially evangelical Americans, to make the right choice. So when the Lord spoke about the borders, I saw in a vision mighty angels of God standing on the US side, and across the border I saw evil mighty fallen angels, and they were standing on the other side. And the fallen angels, they looked at these angels of God and they were hurling insults, threats and vulgarities. They were just throwing at them. Now is a message for the churches. The churches that do not seek me, them I will judge. They have allowed so much of corruption to come inside them. They must be cleansed and sanctified. Let the righteous ones arise and put their houses in order. Let them seek me to know my ways and my plans for them. My eyes are upon them. Let them surrender their ways to me and seek me. I will teach them and guide them. They shall not fail but succeed. In conclusion, the Lord said this: Behold, I am coming to visit this nation. And I want to tell you truthfully, during this first term, that which was assigned for him, he has fulfilled. As far as his part to restore Israel back to its glory. That first part he has done. Now there's another part he needs to do. That is to bring this nation back to righteousness. So that can be done in the next term. Only in the next term. So this is where the Americans must not be foolish to look at the wrong numbers, to look at the wrong facts, and then come to a wrong conclusion. Great things are at stake. So please, I lovingly urge you, bend your knees. Have a regulated, coordinated fasting and praying. Let's follow the Daniel pattern. Fast and pray until your election day. You must never get away from your guard post until the results are announced. Amen. You cannot relax until the results are announced. Because anything can happen, right? Yes. Anything can happen at the last moment. So until